Today's class is on gene therapy. So in this class, we're going to cover a little bit about the introduction. We're going to talk about gene therapy. We're going to talk about types of gene therapy, the main techniques of gene therapy, and some uncertainties regarding gene therapy. So this is basically a very, very basic lecture on gene therapy. From our studies, we know diseases can be communicable diseases, they can be non-communicable, a subset would be genetic diseases. Now, treatment exists for both communicable and non-communicable diseases, the conventional drugs. Meaning the chemotherapeutic agents. However, for genetic diseases, these chemotherapeutic agents, they don't work. Okay. So what are genetic diseases? Okay, genetic diseases are hereditary diseases. What do you mean by hereditary diseases? Hereditary diseases are transmitted. How? From parents to offspring. Through an information molecule. So a molecule carrying information. And that molecule carrying information is DNA. Okay, so hereditary diseases are transmitted from parents to offspring, and the molecule carrying information is DNA. Now, from this central dogma, we know DNA is the hereditary material. This gets transcribed to messenger RNA. This messenger RNA gets translated to proteins. So what are proteins? Proteins are macromolecules. They have a three-dimensional structure. And this 3D structure is responsible for the function. So, we said that DNA is the hereditary material. And this hereditary material is transcribed to messenger RNA and it is translated to protein. proteins. And proteins are macromolecules having 3D structure, and that structure is responsible for function. So we are talking about hereditary diseases. Hereditary diseases. So what's the problem with hereditary diseases? The proteins, they may not have the function. Okay? So why don't they have function? Because their structure changes. Structure changes. We said that structure is responsible for function. In hereditary diseases, there is a change in the function. Why there is a change in the function? Because the structure of the protein changes. Why does the structure of the protein changes? Because the structure of DNA changes. Okay. So changes in the DNA sequence, we call it mutations. So mutations result in a different transcript. A messenger RNA transcript that is different from the original DNA that is produced, that gets translated to form a protein, and that protein, because the messenger RNA is different, the amino acid sequence will be different. If the amino acid sequence will be different, then the structure will be different. If the structure is different, then it may not have the actual function. So we are telling, in effect, that hereditary material, the DNA undergoes some changes in the sequence. That results in a protein which has got less function. Okay, let's see what other things can happen. Suppose there is a sequence, AGCT, let's say this is a sequence. The original sequence, we call it the wild type. Okay. And suppose it undergoes some change here. Let's number this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So this is a 24 base pair sequence. And suppose, let's say this gets deleted. Okay, so we get a truncated transcript. Truncated transcript. The messenger RNA will not have information for this. And that can result in a different structure of the protein. Okay, let's consider another scenario. Suppose this sequence, so the sequence from say 4 to 16 actually codes for a protein. And the first scenario we said that there is a deletion, this much is deleted. So we get a truncated protein, meaning the truncated transcript, meaning there is some deletion. Sometimes what can happen, this entire region can be missing. So if this whole region goes missing, there won't be a protein. Okay, no protein will be synthesized. So first we said there can be difference in function. There can be sometimes no protein itself. Okay. There can be other cases where there is overexpression. Okay, say, suppose the normal wild type person produces 10 millimolar micromolar concentration of protein. Okay, per day. There may be a mutated individual who is producing, say, 1,000 micromolar per day. Okay, so let's call this picomolar. Okay. Picomolar concentration per day. Now, we say that this person is overexpressing. That means there is lots of messenger RNA that is being produced, and those lots of messenger RNA is producing lots of protein. Okay, and that is causing a problem. So there can be overexpression of the protein, overexpressing protein. So there can be overexpression. So by gene therapy, we intend to correct these problems. Okay, so let's write down what was the problem again. First, we said there is an abnormal protein is produced. Second, protein is absent. Okay. The third, we see there is an over expression of protein. So this is the problem. How can we correct the problem? Okay, the first one is, so these two, how can we solve these two problems? We can solve them by replacing the gene. Okay, so if you can replace the gene, then this problem will be solved. The second solution is overexpression of protein, meaning from DNA, increased messenger RNA is produced, and that is bringing about increased protein. So you want to reduce the messenger RNA, that becomes protein. So what can you do? You can have an interference. You can use siRNA, small interfering RNA, or you can use microRNAs. Okay. So this small interfering RNA will bind to the messenger RNA and it will stop the messenger RNA being converted into proteins. So these strategies, we can interfere with the expression. Interfere with the expression. The third thing that we can do is we can actually correct the sequence. Okay, correct the defect. Okay, or correct the mutation. How? There are new techniques called CRISPR, okay, which we can use to actually correct the genome. These are currently in, I think there is one drug which has been approved, which interferes with the expression. And to correct the defect, these are all experimental. Okay. So maximum number of drug therapy or gene therapy is the first one, replacing the gene. Okay. So that is the currently available approach. So now the question is, when can we correct the, or when can we replace the gene? When can we replace the gene? Okay. So, we know that there is an egg. Human egg, and let's diagrammatically represent a sperm. Just a single cell. This zygote divides into two cells, and these two cells become four cells. The four cells become 16 cells, and 16 cells become 32 cells, and so on. Now, we can replace the defect, or we can replace the gene in the egg, we can replace the gene in the sperm, and these cells, we know they are called stem cells. We can replace the gene in the stem cell. Okay. So, these cells, the egg, sperm, stem cells, they are called germ cells. Okay, so we can insert the gene in the germ cells. Now, if we insert the gene in the egg, the sperm, or the stem cells, then it is a permanent change. Okay, meaning that change will be transmitted from parent to offspring, and from that offspring to the next offspring. Okay, and it will continue. Okay. So it is a permanent change, and that is why it is called the, it would be a germline change. Okay, it will be a germline change. Okay, and it is a permanent mutation. Okay, a permanent change in the genome. Now the problem is, what could be the problem? The problem number one would be, it is permanent. Okay. And the second problem is, we do not have idea about the safety. Why? Because such therapy has been in existence only for maybe a decade or so. So we do not know the long-term toxicities. We do not know. Okay. We are changing one gene, and we say that one gene has got one function. So this function was not there, so we replaced the gene and we have got back the function. But that's not how the cell works. Every gene crosstalks, meaning it modifies the functioning of many other genes. And so we do not know what will be the effect of replacing one gene on all the other genes. So we do not know, we don't have the information. So because of all these problems, and because any change becomes permanent and it will be interfering with normal evolution, okay, and it also has got the potential for eugenics, okay, meaning you're trying to select certain characteristics, and so there is a potential for using this technology for eugenics. So because of some or all of these reasons, germ cell modification or gene therapy targeted at the germ cells is considered at this point of time unethical. Okay, unethical, and it is not allowed. Okay, so the regulatory bodies don't give approval, and it's not approved. Okay, so then the question is, what else can we do? So the second option is this 1632 cells ultimately becomes a individual. Okay, so almost all these cells undergo the terminal differentiation, and so we can target those cells, and those cells are called somatic cells. So we can target the somatic cells for gene therapy, and this is approved. Okay, most of the currently approved germ cell therapies, gene therapies target the somatic cells or the adult cells in the body. So these are the two types of gene therapy. Okay, so the two types of gene therapy is one, germ cell gene therapy, and two is somatic cell therapy. Okay. Which brings us to techniques. So we have said the currently approved methodologies use somatic cells. So, how does, what are the different methods by which we can use gene therapy on somatic cells is our next discussion. So, let's imagine this is a human being. These are all tissues. Okay, you've got the hands, you've got the legs, you've got the thoracic cavity here, you've got the abdominal cavity here, you've got the pelvic cavity here, and there are lots of organs, and you've got the brain here. Okay, so you can directly target this tissues. Okay, such gene therapy. So gene therapy where tissues are targeted This is called in vivo gene therapy. Okay. This is one method by which we can use a gene therapy on a somatic cell. The other way is we can take a bone here, okay, and we can remove the marrow. Okay, culture the marrow, and then we can select cells and do gene therapy on those cells. And then inject the cells back into the bone marrow. Okay, so this is called ex vivo. Okay, so there are two approaches that we can use for gene therapy. Okay, one is the in vivo gene therapy and ex vivo gene therapy. Okay, so currently these are the two approaches. Okay, so now we come to the science. How do we accomplish? In vivo and ex vivo gene therapy. Okay. So, what are we doing? We are defining the problem. Okay, we understand that a person, suppose this is a patient, has got a genetic disease. We find out whether it is this genetic disease is caused by a single gene or is it polygenic. So polygenic is more than one gene. And there is also an interaction with the environment. Okay, so polygenic diseases, there are two components. It is the result of more than one gene. And those genes interact with the environment, and this interaction causes a polygenic disease. Then there are diseases which are single gene diseases. Maybe there is a single nucleotide or a base pair change. Single base pair change can cause a disease. Okay, so such diseases which are caused by a problem due to a single gene, they are called monogenic diseases. Okay. So monogenic diseases are the candidates for gene therapy. Usually, monogenic diseases are candidates for gene therapy. Okay, so here what are we trying to do? We are trying to define the problem. We are telling a patient has got a problem. We do genetic studies and we find that it is caused by a single gene. And now we know that because it is a monogenic disease, it can be a candidate for gene therapy. So now what do we do? We look at the sequence the wild type sequence. This is for a normal person. Then we look at the diseased person. Then we see whether this gene affects other diseases. When we are sure that it causes only one disease and we know the genotype, then what can we do is we can consider the normal wild type gene for replacement. We consider the wild type or the normal gene for replacement into the patient. Okay. So, this is a sequence. This replacement, it is a sequence. Sequence of what? DNA. Okay. Now, our idea is we have to transfer this DNA into the tissue of the patient. Okay, so what is a tissue? A tissue is a collection of cells. What is a cell? A cell is cytoplasm closed by a membrane. What is the nature of the membrane? It is a lipid bilayer. Because it is a lipid bilayer, not everything will enter into it. So, our goal is to take this DNA and get it into the cell. But now there is a problem. This DNA is negatively charged. And because it is negatively charged, it will not cross the cell membrane. Okay, it cannot cross the lipid bilayer. This lipid bilayer cannot be crossed by this DNA that we are trying to replace. So now the question is, how can we deliver this DNA? Okay, because of this problem, DNA is negatively charged. How can we overcome this problem? So we need a delivery vehicle. Okay, a delivery vehicle should be able to incorporate the DNA. It should incorporate the DNA and transfer it across the membrane. Okay, so this delivery vehicle, we call it a vector. Okay, so now let us analyze it again. What should this vector do? This vector should incorporate the DNA and transfer it across a lipid bilayer. So what if we make the vector lipophilic? Lipophilic, and it should carry the DNA. So we need two properties. It should be lipophilic. It should carry the DNA. Our solution is a liposome. Okay. So now we have got an option for a vector. It can be a liposome. What's the other option? We look at nature. and we ask ourselves the question, is there any pathogen that delivers DNA? Let's put it in bracket and we say delivers genetic material. Okay, we ask ourselves this question. And from our study of pathogens, we know the one that nature has designed by evolution to be a very, very efficient gene delivery vehicle is the virus. So that becomes our option B. Okay, why can't we use a virus? The answer is, what are the problems with viruses? They are pathogenic. Okay, our goal is to, what is our goal? Our goal is to reach the DNA into the cell. But viruses, what do? Viruses get into the cell, they destroy the cell and release lots of viruses. Okay. But they can transfer the genetic material efficiently. Okay. So, to use a virus as a delivery vehicle, then what should we do? We should remove the ability of the virus to be pathogenic. So we don't want it to be pathogenic. Secondly, we don't want it to lyse the cell. But we want it to transfer DNA or the genetic material. Okay. So how can we do this? We can do this by deleting genetic sequences that are responsible for pathogenicity and replication. Okay, so replication is what results in the cell ultimately bursting. Pathogenicity causes diseases. So if we can delete the genetic sequences which are responsible for pathogenicity and replication, but maintaining other characteristic of the virus, other characteristics of the virus. What do you mean by other characteristics? The ability to enter the cell and release the genetic material. So if we can do all that, then virus can become a vector. Okay, so what is a vector? A vector is a vehicle to transfer the genetic material. So, if we can do these things, then we can use it as a vector. Let us come back to our picture where we drew a... Okay. So, there are different types of... Now, we have seen that we've got two options. What are the options we got for vectors? We have got an option. What is that? Liposomes and viruses. Okay, so let us consider about liposomes. Liposomes, their efficiency as gene delivery vehicle is less than viruses. Okay. The capacity to transfer genetic material is less than viruses. Okay. Viruses are the best. Okay. So currently in gene therapy, viruses are being used. Now, the viruses that are used for the in vivo and ex vivo are different. So, in vivo and ex vivo, we are talking about viruses. Okay, as vectors for in vivo. So, in vivo, the preferred virus is called the adeno-associated virus. Adeno-associated virus. Okay, AAV. And for ex vivo, the preferred viruses are retroviruses. And lentiviruses. Okay. So, this adeno-associated virus, it is non-pathogenic. Even naturally, it is non-pathogenic. It has got lots of isotypes. And it is very less immunogenic. Okay. So these are the three reasons why, three of the most important reasons why adeno-associated virus is a choice for in vivo. In addition, it also shows tissue specificity. Okay. So there are different types of isotopes types, and some of them have got tissue specificity. So because if suppose I want to reach a gene to the liver, then there is a specific type of AAV that I can choose to reach it to the liver. The differences between these two types of viruses is the retrovirus and the lentivirus, they integrate with the genome. So they integrate with the genome of the cell. And so till the end of the life of that cell, these viruses will be expressing the proteins. Okay. Whereas this adeno-associated virus, they don't integrate. Okay. So let us come back to what we were telling about these viruses. So we said that by deleting the genetic sequences, we can prevent the virus from becoming pathogenic. We can prevent the replication, but we can maintain the transfer DNA. In place of what we have deleted, in place of deleted sequences near the promoter site. What is promoter site? It is the place where the replicating enzyme comes and binds. Okay. So in place of the deleted sequences near the promoter site, we can insert sequences of our interest. Okay, in this case, we are talking about about this normal wild type DNA. Okay, so the normal wild type DNA we are going to put here. Wild type DNA sequence. Okay. All right. So how can we reach, now the question is, pharmaceutics. How do we reach the vector to the site? Thank you. So we can use integrating vector. So which was the integrating vector that we talked about? Do you remember? Yes, it is the retroviruses and the lentiviruses. Okay, we prefer it for what? For the ex vivo. And for in vivo, we prefer a non-integrating vector. We are talking about viral vectors. Okay, why are we concerned about viral vectors? Because they are most efficient. All right, so the non-integrating vector we said AAV. Now the question is, how can we reach the vector to the site? We can give it as an injection. Okay, we can use a gene gun. Okay, we can use electroporation. Okay, if it's a liposome. Okay, you can use a gene gun if you are using a naked DNA. Okay, you can use that gene gun. If it is a virus, you can give it as an infusion. If it's a virus, you can give it as an infusion. Okay. And if you want to do an ex vivo, what you can do? You can remove the blood out. You can take the stem cells. Okay, so remove blood. Separate stem cells. Okay. And then use a lentivirus or a retrovirus to deliver the gene to those stem cells. Then what do? You can remove either the blood or the bone marrow. And then do an allogenic transfer. Allogenic transfer. Okay. And allogenic transfer is, if you have removed it from the bone marrow, what do? You give some radiation to the patient so that the existing bone marrow is attenuated. Then put the fresh bone marrow with the transformed cells and then allow it to grow. Or if in the case of blood, what can you do? You can transfer the blood back into the patient. Why are we doing an allogenic transfer? We are taking the blood from the patient or the bone marrow from the patient and injecting the same blood or bone marrow back into the patient. So allogenic transfer, it can reduce complications due to the immune response. Okay, so you can do an allogenic transfer. So this is pharmaceutics. Okay. So let's summarize what we have learned up till now. We have talked about introduction. We have talked about the logic behind gene therapy, the logic. Okay. We have talked about the definition of gene therapy. So gene therapy is basically a modality of using DNA for therapy. Okay. Then we have talked about the different types of gene therapy. We said there is a, what are the two types if you remember? Yes? Germ cell and somatic cell. Okay, and then we talked about what are the different techniques. So the main important techniques are the ex vivo and in vivo approaches. Okay. And we also have talked about the uncertainties. What are the uncertainties? We do not know about the possible long-term toxicities. We don't have information about the crosstalk between genes, and this technique has the potential to promote eugenics, and it has got the potential to alter evolution. Okay, so these are the uncertainties. Okay, so in covering all these points, what we have accomplished is to give ourselves an overview. Overview of gene therapy. On that note, let us conclude our lecture for today.